The meeting of the Dudley Charlton Regional School Committee is now in session. It is Wednesday, February 8th, 2017. It is 7 p.m. We're at the Shepherd Hill Regional High School Library. Let's all stand to pledge to the flag.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay. I'd like to begin tonight's meeting by asking everybody to stand and observe a moment of silence for Alejandro A.J. Lorente, a sixth grade student at Dudley Middle School who passed away last Friday in a tragic accident. A.J. is survived by his mother and father and two younger siblings, both of whom attend Dudley Elementary School. Our thoughts and prayers of our school district community are with the Lorente family in this incredibly difficult time. This evening, first item on the agenda is approval of the minutes. I'll entertain a motion to approve the minutes of our regular meeting of Wednesday, January 25th. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Discussion?
Change on page 2 under the additional $28,000 in preschool expenses. I believe that was my comment and not Mrs. Ann Harper. And then I was just wondering on page 4 under item D, the last sentence under the school building, the Shepherd Hill Building Committee report, the last sentence is a little bit awkward, and I know Mr. Matthew had stated that there was little interest in providing us with service from these vendors regarding the SOI, but I recall it being more along the lines of there's a little interest, but the information that he gained, that you gained from the conversation, would be helpful in assisting us when we move forward with the project. So I don't know how to reword it, but that sentence is awkward.
Okay, any ideas to give us the wording of that?
To Mr. Matthew, I just recall you saying that the conversations were very productive, although they weren't interested in providing that service. The conversations were very productive and would help us moving forward. We were able to gain some things that would help us tweak the SOI on our own.
Yeah, in essence, they indicated that, you know, it's not a service that they commonly have done before, weren't aware of other firms that not necessarily provided that. But just the conversation itself gave us some insight in terms of how to possibly rework the SOI.
Okay, with that explanation, we'll put it in the minutes. Anyone else? Okay, all in favor? Motion carries, it's unanimous. Approval of the warrant. This evening we do have a warrant, and it'll make its way around the table. And that brings us up to Citizens Forum this evening. Do we have anyone that would like to come forward, speak with us? Okay. And the school spotlight is postponed, so we will skip that. And communications, Mr. Desto.
I do not have any tonight, Mrs. O'Coin.
Okay, and I do not have any. How about our members?
Actually, just more of a commentary. I know myself and Mrs. Antossi were both at the Show Choir Festival on Friday night. I think it's important to just make a public statement. The performances that were put on by both Dudley Elementary School, Charlton Middle School, I'm sorry, Dudley Middle School, Charlton Middle School, and our Shepherd Choir, Fantasy and Illusion. It's just so proud to sit in the audience and watch the talent that these students possess, and I know they work very hard. There was a little bit of a glitch on Friday night with the music to the Charlton Middle School show choir performance, that they actually had to stand on stage, which was, seemed like an enormous amount of time, which ultimately probably was seconds, but the fact that they just maintained their professionalism and their grace under those adverse conditions, I know just the people that I was sitting with were not from our district. Our students did us so proud. I know they work really hard, so I just would like to give the schools and the people that work so hard a shout out.
Thank you.
Thank you, Elaine. Anyone else?
I have something. I attended the story of a building at Bay Path this past Monday along with Mr. Matthews and Mr. Chaplin, and we got a lot of great information. They put a binder together for us that had a lot of great information on how to proceed forward with a building project. It started out with Mr. LaFleche and a panel of individuals, the project manager, the construction people, the principal, a number of other folks that were involved in the project, doing kind of a tips and techniques and what have we learned from our experience type of question and answer session, which was really beneficial. One of the things that struck me was how involved they got the students along the project. From beginning to end, the students were involved in, you know, being there when they're pouring the cement, to everybody in the whole school signing a beam that is proudly displayed in the library. I thought that was really outstanding and something that we would want to think about when we're hopefully moving forward with our project. The MSBA also discussed the preparation of the statement of interest and resources that they have available on their website, which was really helpful, and all the way up to outfitting a new school with furniture and so forth, and how you get the best prices and that sort of thing. So we did come away with a lot of good information that we can talk about at the subcommittee, and also how to formulate the subcommittee and the types of people that should be involved in the group.
Thank you.
So, very, very helpful.
Thank you. Good report. Anyone else? Okay, superintendent's report, Mr. Desto.
Thank you, Mrs. O'Coin. So first thing, we had scheduled a budget task force meeting for tomorrow night. That is obviously, it had already been determined that I wasn't going to go, but now with the weather, it's going to be canceled. Nonetheless, so I just wanted to make sure everybody knows. I don't think anybody was in a hurry to go to Uxbridge tomorrow night with the weather like it is anyway. I want to give you an update on the Massachusetts Nurses Association. I received yesterday the official document from the Department of Labor Relations certifying a written, what they call written majority authorization. So this means that a majority of our school nurses have voted to be represented in collective bargaining by the Mass Nurses Association. Attorney Cosgrove indicates that we will now soon be contacted by the Nurses Association to set dates and times to begin bargaining. And when contacted, I will ask for several possible dates and times to bring back to the committee. And once we have set a date for the first session, I would ask that the committee select, if it should be your wish, select a subcommittee to join me at that table if you want me to be there as well.
So. Mrs. O'Coin and I do that again because we didn't before. Does anyone else want to be on it? Because we had done the
right.
Those.
Anyone else?
Someone else will continue because we've evolved
sure,
before.
That works. Sure. Okay. That works well. Okay. Also, I just want to let the committee know that we are getting toward the point now where we're going to have to post the opening for the principal at Dudley Elementary School. And my thought is that I'll post the position on March 1st. With the thought of starting interviews sometime late that month, around March 20th. So I would also ask that I could have at least one school committee member. We have a search committee already in place with a dynamic group of people from Dudley Elementary School, along with Mrs. Pastore, but I would ask for at least one member of the committee to join me on that as well.
I'll do it.
Okay. Anyone else? Okay, Kathy.
Awesome, thank you. Okay, so, and then I want to correct an error that I had. Mrs. Rabbit brought up the show choirs, and this weekend, we have Dudley Middle School and Charlton Middle School show choirs will be performing at Tantasqua. This is Tantasqua's first time hosting a tournament, and I certainly want to wish them the best of luck as they continue their Patriots-like dominance of the middle school circuit. I don't want to jinx them, but my superintendent's report in the package had said that it was Dudley Middle School, but Charlton Middle School is there as well. And finally, the Leaders Breakfast is still on for Friday the 17th. And after I make my presentation tonight, we'll all be in agreement that there has never been a more important time for us to try to get a little peek at what the House and the Senate are going to be thinking of in relation to Governor Baker's budget. And so that meeting will be at 9 a.m. here in the Shepherd Hill Library Conference Room. And certainly all members of the committee are welcome, but if you can't make it, we will definitely keep you updated. These are always important. It's always important to have our legislators here. But knowing what we know about the governor's budget, it's, for me, I'm really looking forward to hearing their thoughts. And we do have, there's never a guarantee, but we have commitments from Senator Gobey, Senator Fatman, and Representative Durant to be there on the 17th. So hopefully we walk out of there with a little bit of insight and maybe even, dare I say, a little bit of hope. That's all I have.
And Sandy, I'm going to go to that, so
I think I told you all about it.
I don't think I told you. Anyone else?
I'll be there.
Just call Sandy.
I'm not able to tell you.
Okay. And that concludes your report, Mr. Dust.
That's all I have, Mrs. O'Coin.
Okay. And we'll table the student representative's report. Mm-hmm. And we'll go to new business. FY 2018 budget presentation. Mr. Desto first.
Thank you, Mrs. O'Coin. It might take me just a minute to get situated. And Mr. Matthew will be joining me in a minute. Laura, this is my good side. My son says my good side is the bottom of my feet. Okay. So, I asked for a podium because I have a lot of stuff here that I have to keep with me. So, not trying to be too formal, but certainly the topic that we discussed tonight is very serious. And tonight, Mr. Matthew and I will present for your consideration the initial budget for the fiscal year 2018. This budget is inclusive of the majority of building level requests and strategic plan initiatives that will have budget impact in the next year. It also represents, at this point, no loss of jobs or programs district-wide. With the governor's budget released on January 25th as a driver for what you'll see tonight, we approach this budget bowed for sure, but not even anywhere close to broken. We know that we have $2 million in increased set costs and that the governor's budget actually represents a $45,000 decrease to our 2017 budget. So where does that leave us? Well, it leaves us working with our towns, our ability to make wise sacrifices, and a whole lot of need to be creative in the way we spend our money. As a district, we've been here many times before. It looks like, barring any miracle help from the state, we have again been dealt a bit of a lousy hand. But as we always have, we're going to do our best to improve the hand we've been dealt and to play it as creatively as we can. Our number one priority, before I really get into the nuts and bolts of this budget, in essence, our number one priority will be to ensure that while we may feel the pain, our students will not. And we'll work toward ensuring that they will only see an even better educational experience than they had the previous year. And toward that, our budget proposal. First, our budget goals, very quickly, because you've seen all of these before. We want to always, number one, ensure the safety and security of our students. Reduce class sizes with an emphasis on grades 1 to 3. Increase our social, emotional, mental health supports. Progress towards strategic planning objectives. Address as many capital concerns as we possibly can. Always a very important goal for me is to maintain our extracurricular opportunities for students. But of course, we also have to meet our contractual and health insurance obligations. and provide necessary funding to comply with state and national standards. So, following positions are being requested, and four of them are new and one is, two are not, and I'll explain that. But I've got it listed as a net total of six new staff. You'll notice that two of them were approved within the last month by the committee, okay? So we're looking at a grade one teacher at Charlton Elementary to reduce class size. Two grade four teachers. Our grade four class sizes are going to be really big next year, over 25 for sure. An ELL teacher and a teacher of the deaf were already approved by the committee this year, but they're going to be put into the new personnel in the budget on that line for next year, so I included them here. And an adjustment counselor at Shepherd Hill to, of course, increase supports there, and we've known for many years that that's been a need for our district. So really we're looking at four new positions, but overall six that will be in that line item. And at this point I'll turn it over to Mr. Matthew. Don't mess up my stuff.
I'll try not to. To go over some of the revenues inside of the budget, we'd like to first take a look at state aid. For fiscal 18, the governor did propose a $20 per pupil increase, and the net to Dudley Charlton of that is $76,000, which is a nice start. Unfortunately, we seem to go backwards from there. With the transportation estimate on the cherry sheets, it was $1,640,675. I reduced it by $30,000 for right now, simply because we're going through and doing all of the work to make sure that our expenditures and our student ridership will meet the numbers that are projected in here. The way that the transportation budget is set, they use the estimate from that I filed in FY16 as the basis to project towards FY18. But the actual number will be based on FY17 expenditures and ridership. So we're able to look at that information now, and we're doing that, and we'll adjust that upwards as appropriate. The school construction debt remains virtually flat for next year. So netting out a total decrease of state aid of $45,952. The proposed town assessments based on our available revenues, both from the state and our own internal reserves and sources, do show increases to the towns. The FY17 total assessments for Dudley and Charlton were $19,148,653. The preliminary proposed FY assessment it stands right now at $22,164,074. So the proposed increase for the two towns is $3 million. And we realize that that is not an insubstantial amount, and an amount that will need to be worked on as we go through this process. The proposed assessments exceed the minimum requirements by $2.9 million. Charlton, $1.5 million. Dudley, $1.3 million. In FY16 and the previous couple of years, fiscal years before that, the assessments seem to be in about this range of $335,000 over the required minimum for Charlton and $289,000 for Dudley. The state is shifting the burden to local assessments, and we're actually in a little bit different circumstance this year than we have been in the past couple of years. Charlton, if the committee remembers, last year had a significant increase in its minimum required contribution. This year, Charlton has actually gone above its target share, and they're over by $32,000. Dudley remains significantly below its target share, $1.1 million or 6.26%. So what is happening now is Dudley will continue to be assessed the minimum required based on the state formula, as well as the penalty to get it to target share. But Charlton is only going to be assessed at its formula levels there because they're above target and they've reached target. The local target share is determined by a community's property values and income wealth. When the state looked at the formula, I think it was 2007, they determined that those were the appropriate metrics to use for a city and for the cities and towns to be able to make their educational contributions. For fiscal 18, the Charlton required minimum contribution went up by $192,000, and the Dudley required contribution increased by $355,000. Each year, those numbers will fluctuate, again, based on the property values and income wealth. The funding from all sources, the FY18 proposed revenue, as you can see, state aid is down by the $45,000. The town assessments to balance our budget at this point are up significantly. Based on my estimates for this year, I don't think we will have sewer reserves to be able to supplement the sewer costs. And based on the regional agreement, those are assessed as capital, and you see that broken out inside of the capital budget. District reserves right now are planned or budgeted at $1 million. And that's obviously a number that fluctuates during the budget process as we determine what level of support is appropriate based on the budget. The transportation revolving does have a balance of $68,756 that needs to be used either to offset any FY17 revenue losses. At this point, I don't expect any, but we won't know that until the end of June. But I am sure that we can plan on using the full amount available in the revolving account. Unfortunately, we did have a higher balance last year, so again, a less revenue that we have to apply. The capital reserves and donations, primarily for the field project, I'm estimating we can increase that contribution a slight amount for next year. But the bottom line is we are looking at $2.7 million more in revenue in terms of a budget increase with little and really no help at this point from the state. So we hope when we do meet with at the legislative breakfast that there is some good news or some different news coming to us at that point. The additional revenue that we use to help offset the budget is detailed here. For FY18, we're estimating circuit breaker reimbursement of $701,000. School choice estimate of $914,175. Athletic fees, based on history, at $105,000. Cafeteria is a self-supporting fund, but included here to the tune of $1 million. State and federal grants totaling $1.3 million. The contributions to the field project, which you know have been coming in on schedule. Preschool tuition currently at $50,000, and parking fees, which we really don't, we could use towards helping to offset the operating budget, but based on our past conversations, we're trying to reserve that to save up a balance to be able to redo the parking lot as we go forward. But a total offset shown here of $4.2 million, which again is pretty healthy, but it does mean that we have the true cost of our operations is around the $55.8 million as opposed to just the operating and capital budget shown. A breakdown of the proposed revenue, as you can see, the largest share certainly comes from the state and then split, you know, between Charlton and Dudley, with the district kicking in its available reserves, but you know those amount to a very small percentage of the overall budget. The budget summary, as shown here, the operating budget and capital budget proposed for FY18 total $51,578,858, with state aid, Chapter 70, transportation. Our total reserves, along with the MSBA reimbursement, bring us a total of $29,414,784, leaving a net of $22,164,074 to be assessed to the two towns. And at this point, I'd like to turn it back over to Mr. Dusto to...
Thank you, Mr. Matthew. So it's important for me to sort of speak from the heart a little bit about this presentation in a general sense before I go on to this next slide, which is an important one. When we got the numbers back from the governor, we kind of found ourselves in a situation that I would call a dilemma. To be able to put together a budget that represents not only our set costs, but also shows the community what we want to accomplish, at least a step forward in our strategic plan, required us to put forward tonight an initial proposal with really big assessments. As the committee knows, a correspondence went out from my office today to the town leaders, indicating that we do realize we have a lot of work left to do, and that our towns, without some sort of other mechanism, are not going to be able to support these. And we realize that, and I want to be sure that that's very clear. And we are committed to working with the towns to make sure that we find a budget that works for everybody, but we felt it was important to put forth what the true needs of the district are at this particular time. And I want to go on now to say that, along the same lines, of the proposed $2.7 million increase that we have here tonight, 77% of that is for what I'll call level service. It's just stuff that we have to do. It's salaries, health insurance, special ed increases, and technology, not devices, but just technology infrastructure, things we need to do to keep running the internet in our schools, okay? Only 23% of that increase, $635,000, is for new growth items. And those are the new staff requests, the new technology, which is for student use in MCAS 2.0 and so forth, feasibility study on Shepherd Hill, and bleacher rental. So while this increase is large, we feel like it's not frivolous in any way. Where does the money go in any district? I don't know of any district that isn't somewhere between 70, and I've seen them as high as 84%. Goes to salary and benefits for staff. That's the biggest driver of the budget, and we're no different. Some of our other big costs are busing and maintenance and utilities and so on, and you can see that for yourself there. So what's coming up soon? Well, as far as the legislature is concerned, the House of Representatives budget generally comes out before the end of April, but long before that, we have the Leaders' Breakfast at Shepherd Hill. I should have probably put that up there. That's important too, but the Senate Ways and Means then doesn't come out until mid-May. The actual Senate budget, the beginning of June, and then there's the vote on the conference budget and the governor's reaction to that. So you see, we're not going to have any real hard and fast information from the state until the end of April. So we're going to have to make some projections and start getting to work right away. This is something I've said every year that I've been superintendent, all 3 years. We have great people. And that's really what, from what I can see, 17 years in the district, I've been so impressed with the people here. I mean, it starts with the students, and you can't win without good players, and every day coming through our doors are students who are among the, I can't imagine there being better ones. Their families, obviously, are a big part of that. Our staff, our community, our towns, the school committee, who's always put students first. And in all, we don't outspend very many, but we have extraordinarily professional, caring, and hardworking people. And I want to be sure tonight to thank all those people and be very clear that we're going to have to keep doing all those things if we're going to stay great. Because, this is a bit of an alarming slide. And we've got a $2.7 million increase on the table, and that is a lot. But it's important to note the most recent per pupil expenditure information that's full and available says that we were almost 29% below the state average in per pupil spending. About $3,500 below the state average. It would cost an additional $12.7 million just to be state average for us. And as of the FY15 reports, which are the most recent ones available, we're ninth from the bottom, which is obviously bottom 3%. And we are second from the bottom out of 57 regional school districts. So I don't know if that's something, it's not something to be proud of. The success we've had, despite that, is something to be proud of. But this is one that shows local districts, their accountability status. The per pupil is in green on the left.
Just shows you how high up the state average really is from us. As of 2015's fiscal year, only Wachusett was lower. These are a little bit different in the current fiscal year, but pretty close. And I was looking at, we have a $2.7 million increase on the table. If we just had something like another $500 or $600 per student, which would put us in the realm of, you know, somebody like Sutton maybe, or even Quabog, then we would have our $2.7 million gap made up. But we do really well despite that. So looking to the future, we know what the problems are. We've talked about them for years, our use of reserves, the state funding, which doesn't even come close to keeping up with cost increases, town assessments, which are now at or below state recommendations, and simply the expenses of modern education, physical safety, the support for mental health concerns, technology, and increased staffing due to licensure requirements and things that are mandated by the state. But still, we know somehow we must keep moving forward. Toward that, I would imagine that we're going to be talking about some of these things starting next week. We can hope for some increased revenue from the state, and I think that's a realistic hope. Staffing and programming reductions are going to be a very real consideration this year. As we always do, we'll look at creative use of staff. We'll have a discussion about school choice. We'll review our use of grant funds and see if they can be used any differently. Obviously, continue to monitor and review health insurance costs. We may be talking about debt exclusions and overrides, if not this year, certainly in the near future. And of course, we'll continue to advocate with our state legislatures and our local communities to try to help everybody understand what we want to accomplish and how they can help us get there. Okay, finally, just a little bit about our upcoming schedule, which I think by now you're probably all aware of. A week from tonight, we have a special meeting, which will be just on one topic, and that's budget. Then we have the leaders' breakfast, and then on March 8th, the principals will present their budgets at our regular meeting. We'll have another subcommittee meeting on the 15th. March 22nd will be the public hearing on budget. And then you can see throughout the spring, we'll have budget updates leading up to the town meetings on May 15th and May 22nd. Thank you for letting me have this opportunity tonight. It's not easy material to get through, and you know, I'm hopeful, and I absolutely, our spirit's not broken, but I'll take any questions or discussion at this time. You can also come back to the table if you'd like me to.
But thank you, Greg and Rich, for a good report. Very
thorough. We wish the numbers were better.
But very thorough.
I think I should have titled my section Lack of State Aid as opposed to.
So do we need to vote that budget?
So we're going to vote. It's a preliminary budget, so we'll have to vote on that this evening. And the bottom line is for the preliminary budget, $51,578,858. And the assessment to both towns totaled $22,164,074. And then I will give you the assessment for the town of Charlton is $13,384,425. And Dudley is $8,779,649. So what we're voting on this evening is the $51,578,858. And I'll stress it again, it's a preliminary budget. So I'll entertain a motion to accept our budget this evening.
Second.
Discussion. Kathy.
I just want to say that I think we have to realize it's preliminary, but we also realize this budget is not a problem of spending because everything in this budget is justifiable. It's the problem of revenue, and it keeps being that problem. They talked about changing it. It's always next year, next year, next year. We know these figures are not sustainable, but we know we should get it.
Right.
So I think we have to reiterate that to the towns. We know we're doing our best, but there's only so much money. But but I appreciate the work. I think this slide about that 77% is level servicing without any changes, 77% is like the whole budget almost.
Right.
Over three quarters is committed already. So it's not a spending problem, it's a revenue problem. And it's always been that way. Every year we go through this, and it's too bad. But you did a nice job in the presentation. I think a lot of good facts here that people can realize, appreciate. We're doing our best, and we need this, but we understand the money's not there.
I also think, unfortunately, over the past several years, we've taken things out of the budget that keep coming back right. in, and it's just going to compound even more as we put them off each year. They're going to have to be done.
Right.
So as we, you know, take a look at this and we decide what we want to take out, possibly, we have to think next year is going to be even worse. Mm-hmm. So,
and when we look at the per pupil cost, I mean, we're very low compared to other towns.
Compared pretty much to the state.
But our neighboring towns,
we,
too.
We trade off with Wachusett for about a $50 bill as to who's going to be on the bottom. In the statistics here, there's a $48 difference between us and Wachusett.
Which so could change from year to year.
Exactly. It's who gets to wear the crown for regional school districts. So I think it's important. And we struggle with this information. I know we struggled with it when we sat down in the budget and finance subcommittee to the realities of what the numbers are. But I think it's important for people to realize that as a regional school district, once we set our budget and that's what's voted on at town meeting, we can't make any adjustments until the following year. So unlike public school districts that are a single town district, they have an opportunity to adjust their budget in the fall if perhaps the towns receive additional revenue that they can disperse amongst their resource, you know, their departments. But we don't enjoy that. So unfortunately, we have to really deal the reality to the towns at this point in time as to this is what the expenditures are, and we'll work through the process. But we have to be extremely cautious until we can have better information coming in from the House and the Senate to really be able to predict even better how tight we run this budget. It is run very tight, and it's a very fiscally responsible district for what we're able to provide. So we're not dealing with this lightly, and I know that our administration worries about this tremendously, but we're doing the best not to have people not realize that the numbers that are given to us for minimum required contributions are generated by the state. We don't generate the numbers. We just deal with the numbers. So, we're doing our best.
I just have a question. If we don't have the technology for the MCAS 2.0, what do they do to you? I mean, is there a penalty?
The answer is we don't know yet. I did ask Mrs. Allen, when we get the governor's numbers, you start to think, okay, wait a minute here now. You know, you just start to think about everything.
Right.
And I asked Mrs. Allen to contact the DESE and try to get an answer on, okay, so if we have to test four grade levels next year, obviously we can't do it with what we have now. We would have to rearrange the schools for 2 months to do that. What would, if we can't do that, what happens to us? Is there, essentially, is there going to be like a waiver for school districts? Because there are school districts who technology-wise are in worse shape than we are. And so we certainly won't be the only ones in this boat. And she got kind of a, you know, there'll probably be a waiver, but we don't know at this point. So really the answer is we don't know. Okay. And so as we present the initial budget, we decided, well, let's keep that number in there because we don't know if we would have an alternative.
Right.
I don't know how you can, I'm just complaining now, and I don't know if this is productive, but I just don't know how you can make a mandate that is so expensive and then not support it from the back.
That's what I'm saying,
I don't understand. So I think at the end of the road, oftentimes there is reason, and maybe we would be able to have a waiver for that. But I don't know that right now.
What could they possibly penalize us? I mean, how could they penalize you?
Well, the thing is, will there be another mechanism by which those kids can take the test?
Right.
As long as there's another.
Or if there's paper and pencil.
If there's paper, you know, you can do that. But if there isn't another mechanism and it's sink or swim, we can't let our kids sink.
Yeah.
Very.
Well, this year they're allowing paper. Correct?
Yes, there are waivers this year. It's the first year of it.
So it's next year that we're worried about.
It is, yes. Okay. Because there's a very strong, as you know, a very strong push to get, you know, 3 through 8 to be on computers within 2 or 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
So.
My other question was, other than the February 17th Leaders Breakfast, do you have other meetings scheduled with the town administrators so that we can keep them involved in the process? Because I'm not seeing a lot of fat in this, if any. So trying to trim it down is becoming a real problem, as you know. So I think it's in our best interest to keep everybody involved in the process as much as possible so that they can truly understand what we're up against and that we really don't have a lot of leeway here.
Yeah, we do. We communicate with them much more frequently than what you see on the presentation. Mm-hmm. So one of the expressions that I kept coming back to is we robbed Peter to pay Paul, and now Peter doesn't have much money left.
That's a good one.
To rob from.
Catherine, at the conference, they had an update on the 2.0 MCAS, and I did ask that question. And I was given the answer of basically, you've known this is coming, so
you should
be dealing with it.
We have. I mean, in the last couple of years, we've really done a great job of increasing our technology that's available to be in the hands of students. The thing is, we've spread it out nicely so that all the students of all the age groups are able to access technology. And now this mandate has kind of got it into a close little cluster of grade levels. So,
anyone else, Elaine?
Just as a follow-up to that piece, I think that certainly the current climate around education is changing, and what could possibly change between the next year or two as far as the requirements are is anyone's guess at this point in time, but we have to prepare for it. And I would just like to caution us to not forget that the goal of the technology piece was to have technology within the classrooms that the students were learning on a consistent basis, and not just the fact that we were going to have technology for students to take a test at the end of the year. And that's something that we are substantially behind the mark from a lot of other districts. I know we have a local district in Leicester that their high school students are one-to-one with technology. So we have Auburn that is in the same situation. So it's, for me, it's not the concern that we're, it's not just the testing capability concern that we have. It's just we're not putting our students in the environment where secondary learning goes. So when they move from high school to college, that's the environment that they're expected to be learning in and existing in, and we're not giving them that foundation of exposure to that type of learning to make them better prepared for college. And that, I know we all share that concern. I just don't want us to not reiterate that for people to think that we can turn around and take technology out of the budget and it's real simple. But we have, you know, a high school of 1,100 students right now that don't have the environment that they're expected to exist in college, and we're you know, multiple years away from being in a position to have that environment, and it's a concern.
Anybody else? Okay, so we have a motion on the floor, and I'll take a vote for our budget. All in favor? Motion carries. It's unanimous. We have a preliminary budget.
Thank you.
Budget and Finance Subcommittee report, and I believe that's Mr. Chalk.
So the Budget and Subcommittee meeting are met last week on February 1st. Thank you again to Mrs. Caballa for filling in. And as we just learned, we know where we stand right now with the upcoming budget. At the meeting, Mr. Matthew and Mr. Desto updated us on much of what we saw tonight. And it sort of helped direct our conversations regarding how we move forward. How do we present it to people? Who do we get involved early? You know, our town administrators, our selectmen, finance committees. So they're not shocked by the number. But also that we have to put the reasoning behind it. Why are we doing this? Because these are what things that we need. So as we have those discussions, I think we just have to keep backing it up that's the reason. We moved on to discussing the rate of pay for substitute teachers. We're going to actually be addressing that shortly in the agenda. We'll let that carry forward that way. Again, discussed our preschool fees and how we compare to surrounding districts. Dudley Charlton is a real good deal for preschool right now, and it may be time to look at our rates and come more into line with surrounding districts and other offerings that are out there. We heard last week at our last meeting, I should say, from Mr. Sullivan on our audit report with a couple recommendations that he had, and we discussed some of those things. One was the need for setting up an accounting policies and procedures, and Mr. Matthew has told us that's already in the works. The other two topics, I'll probably defer to Mr. Matthew and Mr. Desto, who can explain them a little better than I can. And it's looking at the district's OPEB and pension liability and the district's health insurance trust fund and things that we have to do there. And that's it.
Thank you. Any questions for Ray? Thank you,
Thank
Ray,
you.
For the report. Next on the agenda, Director of Finance Operations Report, Mr. Matthew.
Thank you very much. This evening, we do have two donations for the committee to consider. The first is a $125 donation from the Stohigh Insurance Agency for the Care and Continues program at Dudley Elementary. Additionally, Dudley Elementary has received a donation of $50 from Mr. and Mrs. Bromage for that same program. I recommend the committee accept these donations.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion to accept the donations this evening.
So moved.
Question.
Discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Motion carries. It's unanimous.
Thank you very much. The next two items, Mr. Chalk just referred to some analysis of the preschool fees and substitute pay. I know those are separate agenda items, so I'll skip over those for right now. Included with the report was the quarterly update through the end of December. As the committee is probably aware, but just as a reminder, our accounts payable clerk did retire at the end of last week, even though she was back in the office today. She missed us already. So as that office goes through a transition, we're working through and may make some modifications to the quarterly report to make it more useful and user-friendly. So if the committee has any suggestions or recommendations or thoughts about what you might want to see, certainly feel free to reach out to me, and I'd be happy to do that. In the overall sense, I think we're in good shape as we stand right now. I think this report would look pretty similar to ones in past years. There's really nothing that jumps out at this point in time in terms of expected overages, but the year is still young, and I'll continue to say that until June 29th, because you never know when that unexpected expense is going to come up. Just a note on the grants and revolving funds. You'll see that school choice is listed here in the negative, and that's because the salaries that are charged there are all encumbered in the system. So that's why you see that. But as revenue continues to come in each month from the state, that the revenue number will go up, obviously, so that balance will continue to go up, not down. I don't know if there are any specific questions on the report. Thank you very much. And just, I have a note here on the FY18 budget in terms of health insurance. I wanted to make sure the committee understood, you know, the guidance that we had received, which was very preliminary, and the decisions that we made in terms of presenting the budget. You know, as previously discussed, certainly this year is presenting some challenges. And I think one of the things that we really need to strongly consider is that multi-year solution. We've done a very good job of taking care of things year to year, and making those, you know, corrections, changes, et cetera. But I think this budget cycle really points out the need for trying to address the multi-year solution, if not for this year, then certainly for next. That's all I have. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any questions before I go on? Okay. Consideration to increase substitute teachers' pay rate, and Mr. Desto.
Thank you, Mrs. O'Coyne. So as indicated earlier, we have not increased subpay since 2006, and right now our rates of $70 per day, which has with increases based on education level and days of service, falls right near the bottom for local districts. So the increase in the minimum wage law prompted us to come back to this discussion, but it seems like a good time overall to consider what's the right thing to do, even though we might be exempt from the minimum wage law. We have lost, on occasions in my career as principal and superintendent, I have heard from people who say they don't want to sub here because they get paid more elsewhere. But by and large, we do have a good, loyal core of people who serve our students very well. For the most part, our substitutes are very familiar to our students, and they're part of the team. And so, as indicated in Mr. Matthew's memo, the Budget and Finance Subcommittee and Mr. Matthew and I would like to recommend an increase of $10 per day based on average sub. So based on average sub use in the past 3 years, that would cost the district approximately an additional $21,500 next year if we had the same amount of people absent and the same number of people substituting.
I'll make a motion to increase the substitute pay starting in 2017, fall of 2017, for $10 an hour. Excuse me. $10 a day.
So if you want me to read out what the rates will be.
Yeah, why don't you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So here's how it would go then. The base rate would now be $80 per day without a 4-year degree. With a 4-year degree, it would be $85 per day. With a teacher certification, it would be $90 per day. And then we have another tier that's the long-term rate, and this kicks in if you have been in the same classroom 10 consecutive days or in 45, have subbed 45 days overall. So on your 46th day, this would kick in, and that would be the same degree thing. The three different tiers would be 90, 100, and 105.
Okay. And that doesn't have to be consecutive, right? The 45
The 45
days?
Does not. Okay. No, the 10 does, though.
Okay.
I'll second that.
Okay, discussion. Seeing none, all in favor? Motion carries, it's unanimous.
Thank you.
Consideration to increase preschool fees, Mr. Desto.
Thank you, Mrs. O'Coin. So not completely unlike the previous agenda item, we are at the very bottom among local districts in what we charge for preschool fees, which currently is $800 for 2 half-days per week. Based on past experience, we have budgeted around $50,000 in income from these fees for next year, but it costs nearly $200,000 to run the preschool program as currently staffed. So we feel that a modest increase to $1,000 per year, so it's an increase of $200 per year for 2 half-days, we believe that's more than reasonable. And considering what we spend and what other districts and especially private daycares charge, this, I believe, is still indeed a very fair price. So this proposed $200 per year increase will bring in another approximately $12,500 in revenue to offset the cost of running the preschools. It's not a whopping amount more, but we also don't want to increase it so much that we don't have enough. We want our kids to come to preschool with us, if at all possible.
I'll entertain a motion to approve the increase of $200 for our preschool.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Seeing none, all in favor? Motion carries, it's unanimous.
Thank you.
Consideration to approve 2017-2018 school year calendar. Mr. Desto.
Thank you. I'll say a few words. I don't know if Mrs. Antossi or Mrs. Reed want to add anything after. Per our discussion at the January 11th meeting, the calendar has been revised, which the only change is it restores the March parent-teacher conferences. So while we will continue to work on making parent conferences and overall communication more effective, particularly at the secondary level, further discussion in the intervening 4 weeks revealed that the current model is working well for many at the elementary level, and that it definitely revealed that we're not yet ready with a viable alternative to those conferences from grades 5 to 12. So I think that it probably sends a bad message if we take that out. I think we should put it back in. Mrs. Antossi, Mrs. Reed, and I recommend your approval of the calendar as enclosed. And we also, I did speak with Kevin Foley from his rehabilitation of his shoulder surgery. He's actually at home, but he's rehabbing a shoulder surgery. And he said that he was definitely on board with the recommendation for tonight as well.
Okay, Mary or Stephanie, do you want to add anything to it?
I just wanted to add that I, after having some conversation with the elementary school principals, I do feel that it's beneficial to have that parent-teacher conference at that level. I'm still wavering on at the high school level if it's that beneficial or if a different avenue might be more appropriate at this point. So I'd be looking for some kind of work being done in that area. And I also want to add that I did get some parent communication recently, very recently, about if we're looking into combining the winter and the spring vacations into one March vacation, and it was kind of late in the game, but something to consider again for next year when we talk about the calendar.
Stephanie, anything else you'd like to add? Thank you to both of you for serving on the committee. I'll entertain a motion to approve the 2017-2018 school year calendar.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion. Seeing none, all in favor? Motion carries. It's unanimous.
As a humorous aside, Mrs. O'Coin, on the calendar topic, I downloaded a calendar from a charter school, and they go 195 days. And I took the heading off the top, and I showed it to a high school student, and I said, hey, this is what we're thinking about for next year. What do you think? And it had school starting on August 1st, ending on June 25th. And they were not happy about that. So let's just say the high school students will be relieved to find out I was just kidding.
Okay. Last on the agenda is consideration to dispose of obsolete materials, Shepherd Hill Library books. Mr. Desto.
Thank you. So I've got to give, I've got to commend Shepherd Hill Library Media Specialist Anya Kennedy. She has been working so hard to maintain the library, attend to the students during the day, and it's been a very busy place this year. And at the same time, I guess there's the official term is actually weed out the as many library books as possible, because we need to, obviously we need to modernize the John Canavan Library here at Shepherd Hill. So central to that weeding out process is getting rid of obsolete titles from the book collection. I enclosed in the package a description of the weeding process that Ms. Kennedy, and apparently it's the accepted process among library media specialists nationwide. So there was a list of 6,000 plus titles, which was 718 pages long, that would be available in an ongoing basis by request if anybody wanted to look at it. But this is really the beginning of the process of updating the library. And Mr. Chaplin and Ms. Kennedy did reach out to the local libraries. They reached out to, I'm not sure exactly who, but they did their diligence in trying to find out if there was a place that we could even donate, or nobody wanted the books. And so we we're thinking that just disposal of the books is the right thing to do at this point.
Did you offer them to the kids?
We did not offer them to the, I'm not sure, I shouldn't say no, but I don't think we did.
We'll
offer them to anybody. I'll have an open house here, and anybody in the community can come and get them.
Give it an attendance prize.
Free.
If they don't want them and you can't donate them anywhere, in back of Charlton Elementary School, there is a bin, got books, and the PTO gets money off of the poundage of them.
The poundage?
Yes.
Interesting, okay.
So
it's better than burning them.
Yeah, or
tossing them in the trash. Well, there's a lot of fire for the first
one. So if you can throw them away, you can't burn them.
Actually, with our boiler, we might be able to.
Will it look empty in here when we come in next week?
No, because they're all packed away.
Oh, they're already gone?
They're already out of circulation, but they're not disposed of yet. Because we need you to help us with that. But yeah, so this is
that's a thought, yeah. Stephanie, yeah, to get rid of that.
Sure.
Well, why don't could we then
we could probably contact the company.
Check on those places, they don't want them either. even by the pound, because their goal is to get rid of, they have to pay the cost of getting rid of them.
No, I know. Nobody, we already have a bin though. We already have a bin at the school.
I think is included in that. We did. I'll double check.
All right.
But I don't think the bin wants them either.
They might not fit
maybe
the bin.
They're collector's items. Maybe we should save them.
Some of the materials are. I mean, if I had a community open house, we could. There'd be one person in the community that would want that book from 1969 stamp collecting, and I'll give it to them.
Right.
It's just that they're so obsolete that No one really wants them. And you, in years past, would have vendors that give us a penny a piece for them. They don't even want them anymore either. So it is a dilemma, because we're only 7,000 in out of a 37,000 collection. And our goal is to really get to and maintain a collection of about 10,000 books ongoing. So it's a good beginning.
Do you eliminate them now through a recycling process where you take them to a person that recycles paper? How do you dispose of them now?
We're not disposing of any. We're just storing them in boxes right now to go and then then go. I don't even think the paper people want them either. To be honest, they're so some of them can't even be open.
You do throw them out.
Really?
Yeah.
So
you throw them. You bring them to the dump then.
What's our next sports team that's going to be winning a championship? And we can do a big box.
Well, I mean, the committee could approve the disposal of the materials, and we could look into
the
pouch bin as well as the a recycling process. We talked a little bit about the community, opening that up to the community, but then we thought maybe the amount of labor that would go into that would not be worth the small number of people who would want to take a book. If it's okay with the committee to approve the disposal of the materials, but we will make those two phone calls to try to find out if we can, you know, if the by the pound thing will work, and if they're recycled or just simply, you know, dumped into the dumpster. Yeah. Well, it's sad to say. It's sad. I love books, but we do have to update it. And
they do get obsolete, unfortunately.
Yes, the books are not circulating at all in the library. And in library world, it's like, well, part of the problem for that is because it's just too overwhelming. There's just too much there, and you know, I think she has a good handle on it.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion to approve the disposal of the obsolete materials at Shepherd Hill Library.
Second.
Discussion. Any more discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Motion carries. It's unanimous.
Thank you.
Next meeting date, school committee meetings, Wednesday, February 15th at Charlton Middle School. That is just a budget workshop, and it will start at 6 p.m.
I'll be late for that one.
Okay. Wednesday, March 8th, 2017, that will be here at the Shepherd Hill Library, and it will start at 7 p.m. That's our regular school committee meeting. Then we have the Leaders Breakfast, Friday, February 17th, at Shepherd Hill Regional High School, 9 a.m. Budget and Finance Subcommittee will be Wednesday, March 15th, Shepherd Hill Regional High School at 5 p.m. If anyone else knows of any other meeting date that we've omitted.
Just the Leaders Breakfast.
I said Leaders Breakfast.
Okay.
Yeah.
We've said it five times tonight anyway. I'm very proud of it.
Do you have an idea when you're rescheduling the budget task force that was supposed
not
to
not yet, Mrs. Rabbit. I get a correspondence from the superintendent of Oxbridge tonight just to say to everybody, you know, clear it for tomorrow and we'll get back in touch as soon as we can. So I'll certainly update you on that.
So we're off the hook, Kat.
And we weren't going to go where before.
But we were thinking about it.
I think it was pushed to five. It was originally six. Yeah. Like five better.
Yeah.
Future agenda items, FY 2018, budget presentations, district administrators and building principals. Anyone else to offer?
No, not for us, but I know that the Foundation Budget Review Commission is doing a presentation in Holyoke on the 16th, next Thursday night. It's probably the closest one to our area where they're talking, and that's where we're hearing Governor Baker talk about now trying to implement some of the recommendations from that committee. So if you have nothing better to do on a Thursday night and you want to drive out to Holyoke, there are fine restaurants like Cracker Barrel, very
like
close
Cracker
to the highway.
I'm wondering if the committee would like to take up school choice a little bit earlier, the discussion.
Sure.
Yeah, that would
I'm starting to get some calls from parents.
We'll add that on school choice.
So maybe the first meeting in March.
Anyone else? If you think of anything, just call in or email us.
How about anything on the building subcommittee? Would there be anything?
It's possible. We're kind of in an ongoing thing with that, so we'll sort of fill you in as we can. And I think we need to talk with Mr. Chaplin, those of you who were at the thing on Monday, I need to talk with, to kind of get a sense of what we learned there.
Okay. I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? We're adjourned.